Now, this opens with the vision of Obadiah, and I should read the entire first verse. The vision of Obadiah. Thus saith the Lord God concerning Edom. We've heard a rumor from the Lord, and an ambassador is sent among the heathen, that is the Gentiles, the nations. Arise ye, and let us rise up against her in battle. Now, this is the vision of Obadiah. And again, somebody is going to say, well, who's Obadiah? Well, I don't know, and I hope you won't let that word get out, because there's some people here in Southern California that think I know. I don't know. And the very interesting thing is that though I've read quite a few books on Obadiah, I never found anybody that did know who he is. So I don't mind joining that illustrious group of those who do not know who Obadiah is. And I just have to answer that very truly. Now, his name, as we've indicated, was a very common name in Israel. It's rather like Abdullah is among the Arabs today. And by the way, Abdullah means servant of God. So Obadiah and Abdullah, two names that were common among those people over there. But this Obadiah, we know nothing about. And we have here a book that a great many people feel like it's, you know, something that's not worth even fooling with. If it even dropped out of the Bible, you wouldn't lose very much. And I frankly think you'd lose a great deal. It seems to deal with that which is past largely, yet in it is a great message for us today. And what you have here is not that which is cold ashes, but you have here spewing hot lava. And it has a message for you and me today. And Obadiah tells us immediately, bluntly, and to the point here, he begins, as we have seen, the vision of Obadiah. But right away he says, thus saith the Lord God concerning Edom. And we now are going to ask another question. Who's Edom? Who are we talking about? Well, we find down in verse 6 that we gave you a moment ago as a key verse. It reads, and I'll read it again, how are the things of Esau searched out? How are his hidden things sought out? Now, I consider that, I believe, is the key to the book. And if we're going to find out now about Edom, we're going to have to go back and look at Esau. Who is Esau? Because we're told something very interesting back in the book of Genesis. In the 36th chapter, verse 1, it says, now these are the generations of Esau. Who is Edom? And so the little nation of Edom came from Esau, just as the nation Israel came from Jacob. And now notice another statement here in Genesis 36, now verse 8 and verse 9. Thus dwelt Esau in Mount Seir. Esau is Edom. Now again, and these are the generations of Esau, the father of the Edomites in Mount Seir. And I'm of the opinion that when Moses wrote that, he did not know that the Spirit of God was having him emphasize that for a purpose. Because when we come to Obadiah now, and also to Malachi, we want to know who Edom is. Well, Esau is Edom. The nation Edom came from Esau. Edom is Esau. The Edomites were those who were descended from Esau. And now the story of Esau and Jacob is something that's before us also, and it's quite interesting. They were twin brothers, sons of Isaac and Rebekah. They were not identical twins. Actually, they were opposites. And you go back to the 25th chapter of Genesis now, and let me just reach in and lift out a few verses there. Verses 22 and 23. It says, and the children struggle together within her. In other words, what we have here is that Rebecca is going to give birth to twins. Now listen, I'm reading. If it be so, why am I thus? And she went to inquire of the Lord. The Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be born of thee. And the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger. Now these two individuals, one struggling against the other. That, first of all, was something that took place in actual life. We find that these two boys, twins, one of them was an outdoor boy, outgoing fella, that was Esau, a hunter. And then this man, Jacob, he was tied to his mama's apron string. He was a mama's boy. And they were very far apart. But the very interesting thing is that Jacob had a spiritual discernment that Esau did not have. Esau was a man of the flesh. He did not care for his birthright. He was willing to sell it for a bowl of soup. And it wasn't that he was so hungry that he was about to perish and there wasn't anything to eat in the home of Isaac. There was plenty to eat, but he smelt the soup that this brother of his had made, and he so discounted his birthright that he was willing to trade it in on a bowl of soup, which he actually didn't have to have at all. He just happened to be hungry, and it was the whim of the moment, and it was a desire of the flesh, and he is willing to trade away all of his spiritual heritage for that. And believe me, that's a picture of Christians today, because this is an illustration of a great truth for you and me today. You see, a believer has two natures within him, and they are struggling against each other. Paul makes this point in the epistle to the Galatians. He says, speaking to believers now, for the flesh lusteth or wars against the spirit, and the spirit wars against the flesh. These are contrary, the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. Now these are the two natures in the believer. The new nature and the old nature, they're opposed to each other. And Esau pictures the flesh, Jacob the spirit. And you follow the history of this boy Esau, and you read, I'm reading now from Genesis 25, verse 30. Esau said to Jacob, feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, for I am faint. Therefore was his name called Edom. Edom means red, or sunburned, actually. And Jacob said, sell me this day thy birthright. And Esau said, behold, I'm at the point to die, and what profit shall this birthright do to me? And Jacob said, swear to me this day. And he swore to him, sold his birthright unto Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage of lentils, and he did eat and drink and rose up and went his way. That is, he didn't care. And thus Esau despised his birthright. Now, as we've said, Edom means red, red and hairy. It means sunburn. And a sunburn occurs when the skin is able to absorb all the rays of the light except the rays that make it red. And it's quite interesting to see that the sunburned man in Scripture is the man who could not absorb the light of heaven, and it burned him. Friends, the light of heaven will either save you or burn you, one or the other. And you'll either absorb it or you'll be burned by it. That's always true. Now, this is the story of Esau, a man who was opposite to Jacob, who became Israel, a prince with God. Esau represents the flesh, and he became Edom. Israel represents the spirit. Now, we have seen Esau in the first book of the Old Testament. Now we come now to the last book of the Old Testament and read this strange language. I've loved you, saith the Lord, yet ye say, in what way hast thou loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, saith the Lord? Yet I loved Jacob and I hated Esau. That's in Malachi 1, 2, and part of 3. Now, that's a strange statement, is it not? Now, God says in the last book of the Old Testament, I love Jacob and I hated Esau. And that immediately presents a problem. A student came one time to Dr. Griffith Thomas, and he said to him, Dr. Thomas, I'm having a problem with this statement in Malachi. And Dr. Thomas says, what's your problem? He said, well, I cannot understand why God says that he hates Esau. Dr. Thomas replied to the young man. He says, young man, I'm having a problem with that verse too, but my problem is different from yours. I cannot understand why he said that he loved Jacob. I can understand why he hated Esau, but I can't understand why he loved Jacob. Now, the thing that lends importance to the little book of Obadiah, for it's the only place in the Word of God where you have the explanation of why God hated Esau. And again, I turn to the key verse. How are the things of Esau searched out? How are his hidden things sought out? Now, Ginsburg, the great Hebrew scholar, translates it this way. How are the things of Esau stripped bare? In other words, in the little book of Obadiah here, there is open before us, for the first time, Edom, or Esau. In other words, Obadiah puts a microscope down on Esau, and when you look through the eyepiece, you see Edom. Not only did Obadiah focus the microscope on him, but Obadiah is God's microscope. And you come here and look through the microscope, will you look? What do you see? One Esau now is magnified. And that has become a nation of 250,000 little Esau. And that's Edom. And you could take a picture to a photographer, a little miniature, and he makes an enlarged picture. He says, I blew up the picture. Well, Obadiah is the blown up picture of Esau. You inflate a tire tube to find a tiny leak in it. You couldn't find the leak until you inflated it. Just so Obadiah presents Esau inflated so that you can see where the flaw was in his life. And you won't maybe find it back in Genesis. You can see why God said he hated Esau. You see, what was at the beginning a little pimple under the skin is now a raging and angry cancer. What was small in Esau is now magnified 100,000 times in the nation. It's interesting to note, God did not say at the beginning that he hated Esau. He had to wait until he became a nation and he could reveal the thing that caused him to hate Esau. Now, one thing we need to get firmly fixed in our mind, God did not say that when the boys were born. He did not say that when they became man and both of them really very miserably failed. One, Esau despised his birthright, and Jacob down underneath that crust of cleverness and crookedness, there was that desire for the things of God. And he went about getting the birthright in the wrong way, that which God had vouchsafed to him and actually gave to him in a right way, and before he could become not Jacob but Israel, why, God had to break him, and God broke his leg in order to get him, and the man limped the rest of his life. And you find him way down in Egypt, dying, leaning on that staff that he had leaned on so many years, because of the fact that God finally got that man and brought him to himself. Now, God never said that he hated Esau, nor did he say he loved Jacob. But you come now to the last book in the Old Testament, and one is a nation of several million people, and the other likewise was a nation. And you see now, Israel has been mightily used of God down through the centuries up to this point. There has come in their history a man like Moses, Joshua, and Samuel, and David, and Hezekiah, and then Nehemiah and Ezra, and on down the line. But Esau, the nation that came from him, became a godless nation and turned their backs upon God. But what was it that caused God to hate him and to hate the nation? Now, when you put something under the microscope, it's enlarged. And instead of having one man, you have a nation now, and Esau has been enlarged into a great nation. And you begin to see the defect. You begin to see that thing that is the real problem. I know that when I had cancer, they took some of the infected part and they put it under the microscope. And you couldn't see it just looking at it, but putting it under the microscope, they told me what they could see. Well, we have here now a look at this man, Esau, and Esau is Edom. That was repeated about three times back in the book of Genesis. Now we are looking at Edom, but we see Esau, and we see this great nation.